Not a con.
Focuses it, places it on an imaging surface of some sort, be it film, be it digital, be it very strange forms of digital. The imaging surface then somehow picks up the light, records it in some format, and stuffs it away in some storage medium and prepares to do the same thing again. This is just the basics of how a camera works. Okay, so now I'm going to jump through various settings and terminology that matter when you're flying a camera, because if you don't have these right, any conversation about photography will fly right over your head and you'll be going, huh? Okay, ISO. ISO actually stands for International Standards Organization. However, in the vernacular of flying cameras, it actually refers to how fast an imaging surface captures light, which is to say, how sensitive it is, or in the case of digital image surface, what the gain is. The higher the number, the more sensitive the surface is. So a film speed of 100 is much less sensitive to light than a film speed of 1600, which is why when you're shooting for dark situations or indoor situations or anything where you aren't going to have a lot of light to work with, you typically choose a higher ISO. Not always, but typically. There are reasons not to. Proportionally, the higher your ISO setting goes, the grainier your image will become. Bad both ways. This may or may not matter, but it does. So this is a blow up of a very small section of an image I shot in my backyard at setting at 100. Roughly the same section at 3200. And this projector's cleaning it up. Yes, officially. What you're supposed to be able to see, which is impossible to see in this image, because the projector is resampling this and smoothing out the graininess, is that this image has a whole lot more hot spots inside it. And if I flip between them, you might be able to get the sense of it. It's rather hard to tell, but on lower end cameras, say what most people who are not out of their minds would choose to use. Most lower end cameras, in fact, don't go above an ISO setting of 400. They might get up to 800, maybe 1600. Very maybe there. And they get really grainy when you get to, they get very grainy when you get to that level of sensitivity. This is because in the digital realm, you have a knob marked gain and you just essentially are turning it up, and in the process you pick up more random noise. So, obviously based on what I've said, if you're having to choose a given ISO to work at, choose the lowest one you can get away with, given the rest of the conditions that you're going to be shooting around. Typical automatic modes range 100 to 400 on a given camera. Depending on your camera, it can get much, much higher. And occasionally it can get lower, but not as often. Okay, next are the three settings, aperture. There's a iris that actually lives inside either the lens or your camera body, or if you can't separate. Gabe, have you pulled out Tactical Overkill yet? Yes. That has a significantly larger aperture than anything I can play with. Okay, charging right along. There's an iris that lives inside the camera at some stage. This iris controls how much light gets through the lens to the imaging surface. This is also called the f-stop. This is because it's a fractional value. You specify the aperture setting is specified as an F, for example, F3.5, which actually should be thought of as F1 over 3.5. This is why, as you increase this number, there is less light getting through the lens. And it's actually a fractional value of how much light that possibly could get through a lens that size, actually making it to the imaging surface. Like I said, F1.8 is a wider iris setting than an F3.5 because, well, 1 over 1.8 is a larger number than 1 over 3.5. I should point out that these numbers, 1.8, 3.5, they aren't randomly chosen, though it may feel like it. You will run into them remarkably often. They are chosen very specifically for a reason I'll be getting into in a minute. Sure, bring those up. Okay, let's have fun. So, this is the camera I tend to use. Actually, let's just do it this way. He and I have the same cameras, same camera body, but we have entirely different sets of lenses. This is a not half bad lens, but it only goes to f3.5. This one's f stop minimum is 4. What's that?
2.8.
Here, put them right next to each other. There's a little bit of difference in the amount of lens there.
And this is 1.8.
Yes.
You see this, the same focal length, the same length lens. This is 2.8, this is 1.8.
So if you want a lens which has a low f-stop, which means, which I'll be getting to, because of course this is one of those wonderful things where you have to have all of this in your head before it makes sense. So I do apologize, there is no logical order. You just have to absorb it all, and then it makes sense. If you have a lens with a lower f-stop, you can absorb more light. If you can absorb more light, you can use, well, a lower ISO setting, which means you clearer images. The f-stop has another interesting function is, as the aperture becomes wider, the depth of field of whatever you're focused on gets narrower, which I'm about to show you because it's pretty easy. This is f3.5. This is actually, I shot this image the other day with this camera. No big deal. If you look in the foreground, it's horribly blurred out. It's clear about halfway, so I think I actually had it focused here. That is the actual focal point. And then it gets blurry in the background again, but since it's so far away, it's rather hard to see it. I turned up the aperture. How do you want to call it, guys? It gets really annoying. That would be an accurate description. It's f22. Now, all the stuff in the foreground is in much clearer focus, but it's still fuzzy. But you have an in-focus distance from all the way from here to here. This is actually a tractor that's sitting in the backyard. That actually the steering column. If you have never seen a tractor like that, I have pictures if you want to see.
The picture of the kitten, oral CNCS, is a very good demonstration of that also.
How wonderful! I had never thought of that. Thank you, Bunsen. I may have nightmares now. Right. Okay. More terminology. Designed to confuse. You will hear the term used faster in numbers of contexts, all entirely independently referring to different things. This is designed to confuse people who haven't heard it before, as best I can tell. A lens that is referred to as faster has a lower numbered f-stop. So the two lenses Gabe just had in here would be considered faster than the two lenses I have, though it has absolutely nothing to do with shutter speed, which is what we will be talking about next, which is the only thing I have in here actually measured in seconds, as in time. The reason it's called faster is since it has a lower f-stop, you can use a faster shutter speed for the same image, given all other parameters. So, you just saw the depth of field effect. This is really useful in portrait work, or if you want to see the subject and you don't want to see the subject's surroundings.
So is that why in like sporting events you see the photographers with the giant lenses?
Yes. Because they want to be able to see. Okay, there's two reasons for this. One, they want to be able to sit 50 yards away from whatever's going on and get a close-up of the guy's chest and head, and that's it.
Yeah.
So you need a long lens to do that. In this sense, a telephoto lens. Often zoom, because there's little sense nowadays in not bothering with the zoom, but we can get into lens terminology in a bit. But they also need an incredibly wide f-stop on it, because they not only need to be able to get from a long